Plants can be an attractive energy source. Other sustainable energy sources, like solar energy and wind energy, can generate large amounts of electric energy. However, they have an important drawback. They don't generate electricity when the sun is down or when the wind isn't blowing. This requires that we store part of the energy in batteries or in a chemical form, for example, by making hydrogen or gasoline from it. An alternative is that we make use of creatures that already manage for billions of years to store the energy from the sun in a chemical form. Plants. Via photosynthesis, plants convert the photons from the sun into biomass. We can harvest this biomass and store it until we need it. So biomass is abundantly available stored solar energy. It can act as a natural battery, but it has even more advantages. Bioenergy is the only renewable energy source that can be co-processed with fossil fuels in existing conversion systems. Think, for example, of oil refineries and coal gasification plants. This enables a gradual transition to a renewable energy supply. Biomass is formed on a relatively short timescale via photosynthesis from CO2 and water. The CO2 that is released then again in an energy conversion system, for example, when you burn it, that can then be bound by the next generation of plants. Therefore, one can speak of a carbon neutral type of fuel. Waste streams and byproducts from, for example, food production can be valorized. These low-value streams can be turned into valuable power, heat, and chemicals. Another advantage is that biomass is already grown for food, animal feed, and natural fiber and wood applications. It is rather easily accessible, and people have experience in dealing with this source. Moreover, the growing and harvesting of biomass for energy can enhance rural economic development via the creation of additional jobs. This leads to additional income for rural regions. You might know that there is worldwide a trend of people leaving countryside and moving to the cities. Energy from biomass might help in counteracting that trend. For obtaining energy from biomass, mostly non-scarce materials are used. In contrast, several other major sustainable energy sources make use of rare materials to construct the energy devices that we needed, for example, gallium and indium in solar cells and the niobium and neodymium in wind turbines. Of course, it wouldn't be fair to tell you only the positive points about using biomass for energy. It has also certain drawbacks. First of all, conversion of solar energy into biomass has generally a pretty low efficiency. Think of the order of 1% depending on the species that you use. This means that relatively large surfaces are needed to harvest sufficient material for application in energy conversion. Second, biomass is characterized by a low energy density compared to fossil fuels. A cubic meter of oil contains much more energy than a cubic meter of wood. This causes challenges in logistics. As a consequence, from this point and the first point that I mentioned, biomass has a limited effective availability, and therefore it can only partly, but still substantially, contribute to the world's energy demand. Although biomass itself is renewable, during the whole life cycle, fossil fuels are commonly used to produce, for example, fertilizers and pesticides, to grow and collect the plants, to transport the harvested material, and finally to upgrade it into an actual fuel. Therefore, biofuels still have, in many cases, a fossil carbon footprint. Another point is that many different disciplines are involved in the successful implementation of biomass. It is a pretty complex chain, from seeding the plants to the final conversion and use, with disciplines ranging from policy development, logistics, to chemical engineering and agricultural sciences. Bioenergy policies might conflict in some cases with other existing environmental or economic policies. For other energy sources, the only key technology is mostly the energy conversion, while for biomass, the whole system is crucial. Another important point is that biomass may compete with food production, depending on the type of biomass and the technologies used. I will come back to that in a few minutes from now. To get land for energy plantation, sometimes forests are cut down. This can lead to a serious loss of biodiversity and carbon storage. This is, for example, very undesirable to cut down tropical rainforest to get land for growing crops for energy use. Also, competition for increasingly scarce water may become a serious issue. And a final drawback of using biomass for directly generating electricity, for example, by burning it, is that you're destroying useful work, sometimes referred to as exergy. Biomass consists of rather complex molecules, and some people say that you better use it to make chemicals rather than burning it. Well, these were quite some drawbacks. Knowing these potential drawbacks can help us in using biomass in an optimum manner and to avoid these drawbacks as much as possible. Let's now take a closer look to what biomass actually is. Biomass is organic matter derived from living or recently living organisms. Normally, we only consider plants, not animals, when it comes to energy supply. Although different plants have different compositions, nearly always there are three important components that give a plant its structure, its sturdiness. These are cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin. Let's take a look at them. The first one, cellulose, is a biopolymer consisting of small sugar molecules linked to form very large, long molecules. The second, hemicellulose, binds to the cellulose fibers to make a network. It is also a biopolymer, but while cellulose is built up of just one type of sugar, hemicellulose has different types of building blocks. Its molecules are also shorter. They typically contain of just 100 sugar units per molecule, while cellulose molecule is built up of thousands of sugar units. And finally, the third one, lignin, gives even more strength to the structure. It's also consisting of large molecules, but this component, lignin, is built up from different units, not sugar molecules, and in a less structured way. It is much more difficult also to decompose than cellulose and hemicellulose. Apart from the structural components that we just dealt with in the previous slides, many plants have other components like sugar, oil, and or starch as an important part. Like cellulose and hemicellulose, also starch is built up of sugar units, but then in a different way, a way that's much easier to break down for animals than humans, meaning that they can be used as food. Such plants rich in sugar, in oil, in starch, can serve well as food for humans or feed for cattle. These plants are also easy to convert into liquid biofuels, but that then means, in that case, that we're in competition with the food chain, which is something that we want to avoid, as said before. This type of biofuel, for example, from wheat or corn, is called first-generation biofuel. The structural components we just discussed, cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin, are more difficult to convert into biofuel, so biofuels obtained in this way, for example, from wood or straw, are called second-generation biofuels. And finally, algae can also serve as a starting point for making biofuels. These are then third-generation biofuels. A different and interesting way of looking at biomass is looking at the composition and compare it with fossil fuels. This can be done with the so-called Van Kevele diagram, in which we can compare the amount of the three main atoms, the three main elements present in biomass, carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. The horizontal axis on this graph gives the ratio of oxygen atoms over carbon atoms, and the vertical axis gives the ratio of hydrogen atoms over carbon atoms. You can see that biomass in the upper right corner contains, next to the carbon, quite some hydrogen and oxygen. Then, when forming fossil fuels from it, the so-called qualification process is taking place, and we lose more and more of the hydrogen and oxygen. Over the years, we first get peat, then further on lignite or brown coal, and then we move to different types of coals, and finally we end up with anthracite, the hardest type of coal, which is nearly purely carbon. So we lost mostly all hydrogen and oxygen. And the other main fossil fuels, crude oil and natural gas, are not given in this plot. Since they hardly contain any oxygen, it means that it would be close to the vertical axis. But enough about fossil fuels. We will, of course, keep our focus on biomass in this course.